Since the inception of SpaceX's Steel Starship development program in late 2018, CEO Elon Musk, executives, and the company have consistently emphasized the utilization of return-to-launch site landings for both Super Heavy boosters and Starship upper stages. However, the certainty of these previously stated intentions is now uncertain. Interestingly, despite multiple announcements regarding the development of marine recovery systems for the Starship, the company's unexpected desire to pursue this avenue raises questions about their future plans. SpaceX's well-established plans to launch the Starship from the sea necessitate the use of a Droneship to land a Super Heavy booster. With a weight of several thousand tons, the Super Heavy booster is significantly required larger than the football field-sized drone ships that SpaceX uses to recover Falcon boosters. Clearly, towing an entire oil rig hundreds of miles to and from port is neither efficient nor economical for rocket recovery. It would also be illogical for SpaceX to hire a dedicated naval architect without disclosing that they would be working on the creation of the world's largest floating launch pad, which is an all-encompassing project. There are three possible explanations for the mentions, each with its own distinct possibility. Firstly, it is plausible that SpaceX is preparing for the potential recovery of debris or intact floating ships or boosters after intentionally expending them on orbital Starship test flights. Secondly, SpaceX may have intentions to strip an oil rig or two, without fully converting them into launch pads, and then use those rigs as landing platforms, designed to remain at sea indefinitely. These platforms could then transfer landed ships or boosters to smaller support ships tasked with returning them to dry land. Lastly, and perhaps most likely, SpaceX could be exploring the potential benefits of landing Super Heavy boosters at sea. SpaceX has made significant advancements in the recovery and reuse of orbital-class rocket boosters through its Falcon rockets. Falcon family core boosters have successfully landed 252 times in 265 attempts. A total of 39 boosters have flown multiple missions, with a record of 18 missions by the same booster. Instead of following the traditional route of coasting hundreds of kilometers downrange and landing on a drone ship at sea, these boosters took a different approach. They executed a remarkable maneuver by flipping around, nullifying their substantial velocities, and propelling themselves back a few hundred kilometers to the Florida or California coast. It's truly a sight to behold as they gracefully touch down on basic concrete pads. However, this maneuver comes at a cost. Canceling out approximately 1.5 kilometers per second of downrange velocity, equivalent to Mach approximately 4.5, and reversing that velocity back towards the launch site, requires a significant amount of propellant. The reentry burn alone, which lasts around 25 seconds, consumes about 20 tons, approximately 40,000 pounds, of propellant for most Falcon boosters. When it comes to landing, the average single-engine burn lasts around 35 seconds, and consumes approximately 10 tons, approximately 22,000 pounds of propellant, for all Falcon boosters. This is usually sufficient for drone ship landings. However, for boosters returning to the launch site RTLS landings, an additional boostback burn of around 40 seconds is required. This burn, powered by three Merlin 1D engines, adds an extra 25 to 35 tons, 55,000 to 80,000 pounds of propellant, to the equation. To put it differently, an RTLS landing typically results in the consumption of at least twice the amount of propellant compared to a drone ship landing. According to the general rule of thumb in rocketry, for every 7 kilograms of booster mass, the payload to orbit is reduced by 1 kilogram. Assuming that each reusable Falcon booster requires approximately 3 tons of recovery-specific hardware, such as legs and grid fins. A drone ship landing may decrease Falcon 9's payload to low Earth orbit by approximately 5 tons. Additionally, the extra propellant required for an RTLS landing could further reduce the payload by another 4 tons to 13 tons. Interestingly, a Falcon 9 with a drone ship booster recovery has never launched more than approximately 16 tons to LEO. Although SpaceX has not provided NASA's LPERF calculator with data for orbits below 400 kilometers, approximately 250 miles. It generally aligns with the notion that Falcon 9 can launch around 12 tons with an RTLS landing and 16 tons with a drone ship landing. In conclusion, landing reusable boosters at sea is likely to always be significantly more efficient. SpaceX has consistently maintained that Starship's Super Heavy boosters will avoid maritime recovery due to the inherent difficulties, risks, time consumption, and expenses associated with landing and recovering massive rocket boosters at sea. It is extremely challenging for rapid reuse to occur multiple times per day or week, which ultimately increases the cost of recovery. This is a significant concern for SpaceX, as they aim to reduce the cost of each launch to just a few million dollars. However, if the cost of at-sea recovery remains below a few million dollars, there is a possibility of simplifying certain launch profiles and making them more cost-effective through occasional at-sea booster landings. If the alternative is to launch a second dedicated mission to partially refuel one Starship, a sea landing could potentially provide the necessary performance for the same mission in a single launch, thereby reducing the overall cost of launch services. Similar to the Falcon 9, if a sea landing can increase Starship's payload to low Earth orbit by a third or more. Regularly recovering Super Heavy boosters at sea would also decrease the number of launches required to fill up a Starship moon lander by a third. Considering that SpaceX and NASA have planned for Starship tanker launches to be approximately 12 days apart, the feasibility of sea booster recovery becomes even more promising. In theory, the Starship launch vehicle, as described by CEO Elon Musk, could potentially launch anywhere from 150 to 200 plus tons to LEO, with full reuse and return to launch site booster recovery. With such impressive performance capabilities, the impact of an RTLS booster landing on payload to orbit becomes less significant compared to Falcon 9 and Falcon Heavy. Whether it reduces payload by a third, half, or even more, the abundance of performance available with Starship may compensate for any potential payload reduction. By the close of the day, a mere 100 tons to low Earth orbit might be more than sufficient to meet any practical near-term performance requirements. However, until the Starships and Super Heavy boosters achieve a level of reusability that allows for routine launches multiple times per week, if not daily, and until the costs of launches are significantly reduced to single-digit millions of dollars, it is difficult to SpaceX willingly relinquishing such a substantial amount of performance by abstaining from at-sea recovery based solely on principle. SpaceX's Starship launch vehicle possesses numerous potential applications and capabilities that will grant companies and organizations unprecedented access to space. Engineers are currently developing the fully reusable Starship launch system at the Starbase facility situated in Boca Chica Beach, Texas. The ability to reuse these spacecraft components enables SpaceX to diminish the cost of space travel and establish a sustainable long-term human presence in space. Having already conducted multiple test flights with Starship prototypes, the company is now preparing for the third full-scale orbital flight test utilizing a Super Heavy rocket. The Super Heavy is specifically designed to propel the Starship into orbit, powered by as many as 33 methane-fueled Raptor engines. Once operational, it will claim the title of the most powerful and largest rocket in history. Starship itself will serve as a versatile launch vehicle, revolutionizing space exploration. Among SpaceX's plans for Starship and its potential applications is its primary use for transporting substantial payloads to space. Standing at a towering height of 160 feet, this stainless steel spacecraft will possess the capability to launch over 100 tons of cargo into orbit, enabling companies to deploy entire constellations of satellites in a single mission. Currently, these satellite constellations require years to complete using the rockets presently in operation. That's it for today's episode. We hope you enjoyed it and learned something new. Please let us know what you think in the comments section down below. Your feedback is very important to us, because it helps us make better videos for you, so thank you very much and we hope to see you again next time.